Actually, what I've been seeing for the last few years, that what Arun and his team is doing, bringing together everybody who's in the same business of renewable energy, doing a lot of advocacy for making this sector stand not only on its feet but thrive, helping people to know each other so that partnerships can be built, and many things which is well beyond what a journal or a magazine could be doing. So I would like everybody to give a special appreciation to Anand. My association with the renewable energy goes quite some time ago, when there were no renewable energy in the country. I was looking after the entire energy sector, which included thermal as well as hydel of Madhya Pradesh. And one of my uncles, who was basically a power engineer, thought that India should do something about renewable. So he started advocating wind energy. And so much so that he got, he was associated with Danida, with World Bank, with Planning Commission of those days, and brought in wind energy at Tamil Nadu, Gujarat, and other places. And then people said that, aap to sabko batate, aap khud to karo. So he started one very interesting venture, in which it was a joint sector activity of Government of India, Government of Madhya Pradesh, and his company. So this is the only type of its venture, but it was established in the 1980s. So from wind to solar is another journey, and I've been also from the point of view, I've seen from the point of view of big power user. Now, I did not know for a long time that India is, as a per capita power user, between one-third to one-fourth of the average of the world. Now, if you say this in context of any other thing, that will make us all dive under the carpet. Because how can you put a GSLV, PSLV, five-stage intercontinental ballistic missile, Agni, which I was associated with Dr. Kalam. And here, as a power consumer, we are one-third to one-fourth of the world average. Very low power consumption. If you see this, then many other things fall into the place. What is the contribution of the manufacturing sector in our GDP? It is less than 15%. Our GDP is 58% or thereabouts is from service sector, which is usually the case of very highly developed countries, where the service sector becomes the large contributor to the GDP. Lesser developed country or developing countries have manufacturing as a big. Now, with one-fourth of the world average per capita consumption of power, can we do manufacturing? We have, I therefore immensely am grateful to the Prime Minister, who had said right in the beginning that make in India, the whole concept is manufacture in India. Manufacture cannot be done without energy. The moment we have high energy demand, many people who have told many things, many of their experiences in the previous two sessions when I was here, that DISCOMs are not taking the net metering is not working and all that. It's basically, why? Because the energy demand is low. The moment energy demand picks up and there is a situation of power shortage, every bit of power which is generated by anybody will get used. So we have to develop not only along with each one some partnership, but also partnership with the organization which will create demand for you. And that is why I said in my remarks in the last session that we should have networking and discussion with the architecture, with the builders, so that new hotels, new new universities, new dwelling complexes must be friendly, must be useful, for the roof should be useful or designed in a manner that you have more power generation from solar. Another sector which will be very important would be also because there is a paucity of land. And I've been saying that India is the best country which can move ahead with large scale power generation on floating solar panels, which should be in large reservoirs. In fact, I have got a presentation, but I thought it would take a lot of time. But I can tell you, I used to also be in the government of India looking after all the water resources of the country. So if we take the large reservoirs itself, the area of the large reservoir is more than 400,000 square kilometers. So if we take one third of that, we can generate 700 gigawatts of power. And they are all distributed all over India. So slowly you will find, and then as the power demand goes up rapidly, you will find that floating solar becomes viable in India. Fourth thing is that we are all, whether we are doing rooftop or we are doing ground mounted, all working with modules, panels, which have been designed in the 1990s with an average efficiency level of not more than 18%. Time has come when 21st century third decade modules should be designed, and in India. Then we will be able to rightfully power or put 350 gigawatts of power, which is in any case a government target. Honorable Prime Minister had said this in the COP21 that by 2030 India would produce 1/4 of its energy from renewable. If we extrapolate, 350 gigawatts will be from solar. Now I am saying that we must also not lose sight of the 1 terawatt market of the ISA countries. And if we focus our attention on that, we cannot win contracts without good technology. So some companies in India, or maybe all companies who are in the business of solar, must manufacture something or other. And therefore, the winning combination would be low cost, high efficient solar energy generation all over the world, especially in the ISA countries and in any case in India. So with this, I leave it to at your disposal, all of you good, bright ladies and gentlemen, to design in India, design new equipment for production of solar energy in India. And we have to do that. There is no choice. I was in the defense sector for a long time, and our vital interests cannot be protected without a missile system. So we designed a missile system. There was no help from any country, and we did it, but we had a person like Dr. Kalam. So everybody has somebody or the other who's like Dr. Kalam, and please, for heaven's sake, fix an equipment and design and then give a winning solution everywhere. Thank you and wish you all success. Thank you.